kind, good Lamson is the last man in the world whom I would conceive capable of a base and cruel action, wrote a Romanian gentleman shortly after Dr. George Henry Lamson had been hanged for the undoubted crime of poisoning his crippled brother-in-law, Percy John. No stranger, more inexplicable contrast has ever been presented to my mind, wrote another comrade, than that afforded by the Lamson who was my friend, and the Lamson revealed to me by the late criminal proceedings. Such a character as his, teeming with irreconcilable contradictions, must ever remain a dark, impenetrable mystery to those who, like myself, were only permitted to contemplate its nobler side and brighter aspect. George Lamson, the kind friend, the genial companion and approved philanthropist, has proved to be the base wretch who is to die the death of a dog by the hand of the common hangman. Well, well, well. So who was Dr. Lamson? He was born shortly before 1850, the son of a clergyman who had become incumbent of one of the American churches in Florence. George Henry was to have many friends in America and on the continent, a truly cosmopolitan man whose experience was not restricted to carefully Britishized parts of Victoria's empire. He started his medical training in Paris, continued in Edinburgh, Vienna, Pennsylvania, and London. He had just completed his first MD in France when the Franco-Prussian War broke out. Lamson served in the French Ambulance Corps and received Bronze and Iron Crosses. Yes, I did say he was on the French side and he got the Iron Cross, until von Moltke's armies easily overran the pseudo-military fop Napoleon III... The French army held the highest reputation in Europe. It was the descendant of Bonaparte's Grande Armée, the greatest fighting force the world had ever seen, controlled by one man. So other armies slavishly imitated French military style and élan. The American Civil War was fought between armies whose uniforms imitated those of poilus. Prussia was not ashamed to use decorations whose names imitated French awards. Military service and adventure suited the good doctor, and in 1876 he went out to participate in the Turco-Serbian War, the kind of Balkan upheaval that our great-grandparents took for granted as the way people behaved in and around those mountains, and that we may yet become used to, since Tito's heirs have proved incapable of stopping his peaceful creation of Yugoslavia from splitting up into its constituent pugnacious Balkan fragments. From this war, Lamson emerged with a gold cross and medal for his services via the British Red Cross. 2 years later, he was Surgeon Major in the Russian service and Chief Surgeon at the Costaferro English Military Hospital in Bucharest. He got some rather downmarket decorations for this tour of duty: the Order of the Star of Romania, 4th class, and the Order of Megidie, 5th class. Still, altogether a valiant and exciting way of spending his early 20s as a young doctor, but one in which he acquired some painful injuries. It was in the Turco-Serbian War that he was introduced to morphine as a pain cure. He continued it after he'd left the continent and gone to America, claiming that he needed it to relieve pain in his lung and as a soporific. Lamson was not the first doctor to become a morphine addict, and he was not the last. Easy access to a drug whose effect has been described as a pleasure approximately 1/4 as strong as sexual satisfaction is an obvious temptation to all sorts and conditions of men. Alas, that the pleasure is not continuous, nor unaddictive, nor without damaging side effects. Some of those side effects are visible in the mental state of the addict, and Lamson's heredity suggested that he could not risk very much threat to his balance. His grandmother, his great-uncle, and his aunt all spent protracted periods in asylums, two of them dying there. The alienists of the time recorded their belief that insanity was hereditary in the Lamson family, so perhaps it is no surprise that some of Lamson's acquaintances and servants thought that he was more than a little odd.
"Man with no memory whatsoever," declared his coachman. "He would order the carriage and when it arrived categorically deny ever having asked for it."
A man obsessed with childish fears and fancies, who was quite unable to talk reasonably. A man who would fail to attend a patient, yet declare that he had been. Yet he was also, as the testimony of many friends confirmed, a man of great charm, a delightful companion, a considerate, kindly, and generous associate. As mixed up and contradictory, I'm tempted to say, as you and me, only more so. His wife adored him, and remained loyal to him through thick and what became extremely thin. He married Kate John in 1878 on his return from Romania. She was a moderate heiress, one of the five children of Manchester merchant William John, who left £10,000, securely invested in Consols and India 4%, to be divided between them. One sibling died before the marriage, leaving Kate with £2,500 as her portion, which came to her when she wed. And after the marriage, another of her brothers died before reaching his majority and taking his share. So there was another £2,500 to be divided between the survivors. This meant that Mrs. Lamson's youngest brother, Percy, was quite a promising heir, with expectations of over £3,000 when he reached the age of 21, a lot of money in those days. And if he died, that would be divided between the two survivors. Mrs. Lamson would come in for another £1,500. By 1881, George Henry would have found that money very useful. Soon after his marriage, he bought a practice in Bournemouth. It was expensive, and it failed. His oddities might be acceptable as a background to social charm. They were quite impossible in a general practitioner. Patients would not go on with a doctor who vaguely declined to talk about their ailments, or remarked that their chests needed to be examined but never carried out the examination, or laughed in the face of an anxious lady who told him her sister was coughing blood. Add that to the fact that Dr. Lamson reported being attacked and robbed from time to time when it was patently obvious he had not been. Add still further his frequent references to his friend Arkwright, who would be making him handsome presents, a friend, be it said, who was transparently as fictional as Mrs. Gamp's friend Mrs. Harris. Add these things, and the sum total is a doctor nobody would trust professionally. They might not suspect the addiction to morphine, or know anything about the family predisposition to insanity, but the public knew clearly enough it did not want to be treated by Dr. Lamson. He lost a lot of money by his failed practice and went to America. There he made a lot of friends, shocked a number of Americans who did observe that his use of morphia was indiscreetly beyond the recommended medical limit, got into the habit of prescribing the rather dangerous drug aconite, a derivative of monk's hood that was fashionable in America, for a very wide range of illnesses, and lost a lot more money. When he returned to England, he was reduced to writing bad checks and borrowing money from friends whose friendship might or might not survive the immediate discovery that they were being defrauded. What was one to make of a professional man who visited a friendly wine merchant on the Isle of Wight and swiftly persuaded him to cash two checks for £30? What was the wine merchant to make of a telegram from the mainland the following day, apologising for Mr. Lamson's foolish error, which meant the checks were worthless? He would explain. What was the wine merchant to make of an explanation, rather later by post, apologising that Lamson had brought out the checkbook appertaining to an account he'd closed and used it by mistake, so that the checks really were worthless, but he promised to replace them with current checks by post? What would the wine merchant make but the correct assumption that Dr. Lamson had robbed him. To clear up these sad straits, Lamson badly needed Kate to inherit Percy's money. There was no Married Women's Property Act to stop him from controlling it and clearing his debts and buying a new practice to ruin all over again. But it would be impossible if Percy reached his majority and inherited his money himself. And the lad grew older all the time. He was nearly 19 already. Percy John was a cripple. He had curvature of the spine and paralysed legs. Notwithstanding, he was a popular pupil at Blenheim House Academy in Wimbledon, that heartland of variegated little private schools with hideously hued caps and blazers. Percy was trundled and carried around in a wheelchair, but other pupils were happy to do this, and the headmaster and the matron were pleased to have him in the school. Pleased, too, to welcome his brother-in-law, Dr. Lamson, as a visitor. The doctor knew several of Percy's friends by name and was obviously a benignly friendly character. Percy was expecting to spend Christmas 1881 with the Lamsons. At the beginning of December, he wrote to his sister Kate, "Dear old kitten, we break up on the 20th Tuesday. I will write and tell you by what train I'm coming." Now, if Dr. Lamson had an evil plan in his mind to rid the earth of Percy before he grew up, why couldn't he have waited until Christmas, and then ingeniously seen to it that the paralysed lad expired of a surfeit of surfeiting in a welter of rich and indigestible hospitality? Did the doctor have to go to the continent, as he claimed, leaving him incontinently desperate to order his mourning clothes for the passing of the obstacle to Kate's inheriting £1,500? Or was the doctor just mad and incapable of thinking rationally about the totality of his actions? I suspect the latter. At any rate, the good doctor wrote to Percy that he wanted to come and visit him at school. "I leave for Paris and Florence tomorrow," he said, "and should wish to see you before going, so I purpose to run down to your place as early as I can, for a few minutes even, if I can accomplish no more. Believe me, dear boy, your loving brother, G.H. Lamson." As we all know, posts were frequent and reliable 200 years ago. You could post that at 6 p.m. in Bournemouth, confident that it would be delivered by 7 a.m. the following morning in Wimbledon. Not that it needed to be. Dr. Lamson didn't actually reach the school until 7 p.m. 2 days later, and he came bearing a Dundee cake and a box of crystallised fruits to tickle the adolescent palate with seasonal festivity. No doubt Percy John studied the classics. No doubt he knew the common Virgilian tag, "Timeo Danaos nec dona ferentes." I fear the Greeks not less when they are bearing gifts. Few scholars have had better reason to fear a gift-bearer from the Balkans. Mr. Bedbrook, the headmaster, greeted the visitor and led him into the ground-floor dining room, where guests were invited to entertain boys. Percy was carried in by a young man called Banbury, who had just technically left school after passing his army exams. Lamson recognised him and called out jovially, "I thought you'd have been in India by this time." Then he turned to his brother-in-law with the comment, "Why, how fat you are looking, Percy!" He accepted Mr. Bedbrook's offer of a glass of sherry, but asked if he might have some sugar in it, offering the extraordinary explanation that most sherries are fortified with brandy, and the sugar would neutralise the excess alcohol. Mrs. Bowles, the housekeeper, brought in a bowl of caster sugar, and Lamson ruined his sherry with a spoonful of it and stirred it vigorously with his penknife. Then he took out the Dundee cake he had brought, cut it into slices with the same penknife, and handed it round. Mr. Bedbrook and Percy each took a few crystallised fruits as well. A pleasant pre-Christmas toast and a treat for a favoured handicapped senior pupil. Shortly before he left, Lamson remarked that he had thought of Blenheim House Academy when he'd been in America, where he was shown some new-style capsules for taking nauseating medicines. Knowing the difficulty teachers have putting unpleasant substances into schoolboys, he wondered whether they would find them useful. He held out a box of the capsules to Mr. Bedbrook, who took one and swallowed it experimentally. It went down easily, but of course it was empty. Then Lamson turned to Percy.
"Here, Percy," he said. "You're a swell pill-taker."
America had evidently affected his vocabulary.
"Take this and show Mr. Bedbrook how easily it may be swallowed."
With that, he filled a capsule with caster sugar from the bowl beside him, and Percy cheerfully swallowed it. A few minutes later, Lamson had left, saying he had already missed his train to London Bridge. Percy was taken ill after he went to bed that night. He suffered desperate fits of vomiting, and at 11:30, he died. Two doctors who were visiting Mr. Bedbrook socially could make nothing of his symptoms, and the police and the coroner were informed. Lamson was already in Paris when the news of his brother-in-law's death reached him, but he came straight home and went directly to Scotland Yard, since, it was said, the police urgently wanted to interview him. They did more. They arrested him on the spot. The analyst had found Percy's body to be full of aconite. Lamson was not only known to have used this dangerous drug liberally in America, he had recently bought 2 grains from Allen and Hanbury's in Lombard Street, a quantity which the assistants thought very large, and only gave him when they confirmed that his name was in the medical directories. Lamson stood to gain by Percy's death, and he urgently needed to gain. Percy had eaten cake and a capsule handed him by Lamson. No other person in the house suffered the remotest trace of food poisoning. Lamson was tried before Sir Henry Hawkins, a notable hanging judge, and condemned to death. Subsequently, Sir Henry remarked that the prosecution had missed what he believed was a very cunning trap Lamson had laid. Sir Henry was sure that the capsule was entirely innocent. It had been filled with sugar Lamson himself had tasted in his sherry, and both Mr. Bedbrook and Mrs. Bowles had watched the doctor fill the capsule. Sir Henry thought that Lamson assumed the prosecution would fix on the capsule as the means of administering the poison, and hey presto, just because he was no conjurer, Lamson would prove himself innocent. In fact, Sir Henry believed the poison had been carefully injected into a prominent raisin on the surface of the cake, and Lamson had ensured that Percy got the only lethal slice, while all the others appeared to prove that the cake was really innocuous. Hanging Hawkins may have been right. Or Lamson may actually have been a better prestidigitator than he imagined, and slipped the aconite into the capsule, or even somehow used his penknife to introduce it to Percy's cake. He certainly seems to have made a great show of seeing that everyone knew he used his penknife to stir his sherry and cut the cake. By his own subsequent admission, he had long experience of the addict's cunning in hiding his drugs and syringes. But in any case, I don't really think Dr. Lamson should have hanged. I think his reason was genuinely shaky, and as he wrote in a very confused statement composed in the condemned cell, his drug abuse meant that he had very little power of perceiving reality or knowing right from wrong. Lamson didn't say this to try and escape the gallows. He said it in urging the authorities to have his brain dissected, to see whether science could learn something about the motor effects of morphine abuse. He was sure his relatives would approve. They might have done. The authorities didn't. They buried Lamson inside the prison, where they killed him, as was their wont.